very zealous, soul-winning young preacher recently went out to a farmer who was working out in his field. Being concerned about the farmer's soul, the preacher asked the man, "Are you laboring in the vineyard of the Lord, my good man?" Not even looking up at the preacher, he continued working. The farmer said, "Nah, these are soybeans." "You don't understand," said the preacher. "Are you a Christian?" With about the same amount of interest, the farmer replied, "Nope, my name is Jones. You must be looking for Jim Christian. He's got the farm about a mile south of here." The young determined preacher tried again. "Are you lost?" "Nah, I've lived here all my life," answered the farmer. "What you looking for?" "Are you prepared for when Jesus returns?" The frustrated preacher finally asked. Well, that caught the farmer's attention. "Well, when's it going to be?" Thinking he finally accomplished something, the young preacher looked over at the farmer and said, "Well, it could be today, could be tomorrow, or maybe the next day." Taking a handkerchief from his back pocket, he wiped his brow and said to the preacher, "Well, don't mention it to my wife. She don't get out much, and she'll probably want to go all 3 days." You know, over my years in ministry, I've noticed there's an awful lot of people who are almost as confused as this farmer is regarding the return of Jesus. Most Christians know Jesus will return again, but so many have preached so many different things regarding the return of Jesus that the whole issue has often been muddied up with a lot of strange theories. Today I want to look at just plain Bible teaching, simple teachings about the Bible. Here he comes, finishing up the series about here he comes, Jesus' return. But first, let's begin with prayer. Lord, I do thank you for the scriptures, and I ask, Lord, that you help me to be honest to the scriptures, to be sincere with this, to teach the truth about what happens when Jesus returns. Lord, may we understand and may we be prepared, whether it is today, tomorrow, or the next day, or whenever it is, help us to be ready when Jesus returns. What a glorious day that will be. In Jesus' name, amen. To me, the most important thing of all when considering the return of Jesus is what Paul wrote to the Christians in 1 Thessalonica. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, he wrote and called it the words of comfort. The words of comfort. Comfort one another with these words. I'm going to read starting in verse 13 of chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians. "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words." In this passage, this is said to be the words of comfort for every Christian. The Holy Spirit inspired Paul to write that when Jesus returns, he will bring back those who have died in him. In other words, that when the rest of the scriptures tell us, like things when Jesus told the thief on the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise," or the scripture where Paul writes that to die is gain because he would go home and be with the Lord, and right now he is absent from the Lord in his body, but when he dies he's going to go home and be with the Lord. The scriptures are very clear that when we die we go at home with the Lord. We go directly to the Lord, no long sitting, lying in a grave, waiting for the day of judgment, but rather we go home to be with the Lord. And when that happens, and when Jesus returns, there's going to be two very important things that happen. That at the shout, at the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, then the dead in Christ will rise first. And for years, this used to really confuse me. Because first of all, he said that the dead in Christ are with the Lord, and they will come with the Lord when he returns, and then the dead in Christ will rise first. And I was going, wait a minute here, how can that be? Are they with God or with the in the grave? What's going on here? It took me a long time to realize what was going on. took me a long time to connect 1 Corinthians 15 and other Bible passages to this one to understand what he was really talking about. That when we die, our spirit, our soul, goes home to be with the Lord. And according to 1 Corinthians 15, that in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we are all going to be changed from mortals to immortals. Our bodies will no longer be an earthly mortal body that slowly deteriorates over the years. Instead, we are going to be given an eternal, immortal body, a permanent body for our soul to dwell in. However, our soul and spirit has left this body when we die and our bodies are put into the grave. Our soul and spirit goes home to be with the Lord God Almighty, so that when He returns, He brings our soul and spirit and resurrects our body, that we will now have an immortal, a no longer in pain body, a body that never has any problems. And that's why Paul, who was inspired by the same Holy Spirit, wrote in 1 Corinthians 15, that we plant a seed in the ground, and it's not that seed that comes up. It's a whole new plant, a whole new thing that comes up. It's a different plant. The first seed is gone, but now there's a different plant there. And that was Paul's illustration to help us understand of the doing away of this mortal body that gets put into a grave, but one day it's going to rise up as an immortal body when Jesus comes back with those who have fallen asleep in Christ, and He brings those spirits and souls and gives us that new immortal body in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And so Paul here in 1 Thessalonians 4 is telling us that when Jesus returns, He's going to bring those souls, those spirits of those who have died in Christ, who have fallen asleep in Christ, who are now at home with the Lord, and He's going to come down and He will resurrect their bodies, a new immortal body and a permanent body that will get to stay with Him forever in heaven. And at that very time, just moments later, then we who are alive and are will and remain until that day will be caught up together with them to live with Jesus forevermore. Again, if you go back to 1 Corinthians 15, we read that this happens in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, that we will all be changed. We don't have to worry about if we die right before Jesus returns or 1,000 years before Jesus returns. If our bodies have been decayed and completely disintegrated, whether they've been burned up in fire, whether we've been cremated, or whether we just decayed in the grave, or whether we were thrown overboard and the crabs and the fish ate our bodies, you know, we don't have to worry about that. We will still, our spirits go home, be with the Lord, and He will raise us up with a new body like that grain of corn that becomes a new plant, an immortal plant. And He tells us that those who stay alive until that time, they will also be changed at the same time, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And anyone who is living for Jesus, who had made Jesus their Lord, that means boss, their Savior, who is submitted to doing whatever He's called us to do, even being willing to be baptized in His name for the forgiveness of our sins, we can be comforted by knowing that when Jesus returns, all of us who have trusted in Jesus are going to be able to go up and spend eternity with Him forevermore. Not with this body, but with a new, changed body. It's promised, and God always keeps His word. Most Christians know that the return of Jesus is supposed to be words of comfort for every Christian, but the real question that often arises about the return of Jesus is, when? When does Jesus come back? When Jesus was asked this question, He simply replied, "No one knows the day nor the hour, only God the Father knows." But still, many people still ask, when is it going to happen? They study the book of Revelation. They read commentaries on the book of Revelation and other books of the Bible. They buy and read the most popular bestseller novels regarding end times and when Jesus returns. And they try to figure out exactly when will Jesus return. But let me propose to you three very simple answers given by Jesus Himself. Let me start out by reading from John chapter 6, verses 39 and 40. "This is the will of Him who sent me, that of all that He has given me, I lose nothing, but I raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who beholds the Son and believes in Him will have eternal life, and I will myself will raise him up on the last day." That's Jesus speaking. That is about as plain a language as can be. That Jesus says that anyone and everyone who believes in Him will have eternal life, and Jesus will raise them up on the last day. Now, if we just read the words of comfort from 1 Thessalonians 4, where it plainly tells us that when Jesus returns, He will raise up those who have died in Him, and all of us who are alive at that time, we will be raised up with new bodies too. We plainly can read this on the resurrection of those who have died. It occurs on the last day. So how many days are going to happen after the resurrection? Which happens when Jesus returns. When He returns on the last day. How many days are after that? None. 1 Thessalonians, if Jesus returns and changes us and raises us up, that will happen on what? The last day. If the book of Revelation occurs on the last day, that's it. The resurrection does. Eternity begins from that point forward. And no wonder the book of Revelation speaks about when you get to heaven, there is no night or day. It is eternity. It is always light. Jesus is the light. And all that is on the last day. And Jesus doesn't just say, well, that's going to happen on the last days. He says the last day, singular. Let me read on some more verses from John chapter 6. Let me read verses 44 and 54. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. Again, he writes, he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Once more, Jesus speaks about the resurrection of Christians as happening on the last day. He will raise us up on the last day. We know this. I know there are people who will argue and say, no, that has nothing to do with the return of Jesus. That just has to do with His coming, and people will be raised up, and then there's going to be a whole bunch more days afterwards, whether they say 3.5 years or 7 years or 1,000 years, and it's all going to be this. I'm going like, Jesus put it pretty plain. He's going to raise them up on what day? The last day. Let's consider another Bible passage, John chapter 11, verse 24. Jesus is having a conversation with Mary and Martha, the sisters of Lazarus, who has died and is in a tomb. And John, inspired by the Holy Spirit, writes that Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Now, I realize that's Martha speaking, not Jesus. But she's speaking directly to Jesus, and Jesus doesn't say, hey, wait, you got that wrong. His resurrection is not going to be the last day. No, there's not going to be a resurrection on the last day. There's going to be a resurrection a long time before the last day, and that's when He would rise up. No, Jesus doesn't say that, even though He knew He's going to raise Him up in just a short time. But the concept is in the Scriptures that people understood the great resurrection is going to happen on the last day. And that's what Jesus taught. That's what the other people around Him taught. And I don't fully understand why there are so many people today who prefer to teach that the return of Christ and the raising up of the dead in Christ doesn't happen on the last day. It happens 3.5 years before. It happens 7 years before. It happens 1,000 years before that last day happens. And they come up with all these different theories. And I'm going like, wait a minute here. Jesus is really plain. He tells us He will raise us up the dead in Christ Jesus. And those who are alive and remain until that day, we're going to be changed altogether in a twinkling of an eye. And all that happens on the last day. Now, I know there are people who think that there are multiple comings of Jesus. Are there multiple comings of Jesus? Is Jesus some sort of yo-yo that comes down and goes back up and comes down and goes back up? Are there multiple comings? Let me consider some of the things Jesus taught us about this return, His return, the end of the world, the last day. Let's start over in Matthew chapter 13. The parable of the tares. This parable is told by Jesus. And basically Jesus shares about a man who's got a field. He sends his servants out to go sow the good seed on his property. And they go out and sow all this good seed on the property. But during the night, the enemy comes and sows tares, weeds, in amongst all the good seed. And as it sprouts up, the servants notice that there's weeds mixed in with the good plants. And they come to the master and say, do you want us to go pull up all the weeds? And said, no, let them grow together. And we'll wait until the harvest. We'll wait until the end of the times, and then we'll harvest them up. And later on in this same chapter, Matthew chapter 13, starting in verse 36 through 43, his disciples came to Jesus and said, we're not catching on to this parable of the tares. Can you explain it? And so Jesus starts explaining it to them. Let me read starting here, verse 37. And Jesus said, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. Verse 38, and the field is the world, and as for the good seed, these are the sons of the kingdom, and the tares are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil, and the harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. So just as the tares are gathered up and burned with fire, so shall it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send forth his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all stumbling blocks and those who commit lawlessness, and will throw them into the furnace of fire, and in that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then, after the weeds have been pulled up, then the righteous will shine forth as the son of the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear. Now here he doesn't call it the last day, he calls it the end of the age. Basically, last day. This is the harvest. When the harvest is done, all of them will be gathered up. But did you notice who gets gathered up first? The what? The wicked are gathered up first. He gathers up the wicked, the weeds. He gathers them up and tosses them into the lake of fire, and then the righteous will shine. And that's what Jesus says. And you know what? That's the exact opposite of what so many people today teach. They say that at the end of the age, Jesus is going to come down like a yo-yo. He's going to come down and pull all the righteous people out and leave all the wicked people there, and they're going to suffer a whole bunch of time. And then later on, there's another end of the age or another last day, and that's going to happen. Even though the scripture told us that Jesus is going to change us all on the last day. And here when he talks about it at the end of the age, there's this huge gathering in of the harvest, and the first people that are gathered up out of that harvest on that harvest time are the wicked people thrown into the fire, and then the righteous shine. Totally opposite of what so many people teach today. And I look at this and go, Jesus didn't just do it in a parable. He told the explanation and he put it in this order. Why do people want to change it around? I don't know. Let's look at another parable Jesus told in the same chapter. Matthew chapter 13, starting in verse 47. It's the parable of the great dragnet. This is recorded here, starting in verse 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that's cast into the sea and gathering fish of every kind. And when it was filled, they drew it up on the beach and they sat down and gathered the good fish into containers, but the bad they threw away. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come forth and take out the wicked from among the righteous. Take out the wicked from among the righteous and will throw them into the furnace of fire. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Again, Jesus is talking about the end time, the great harvest, last day, end of the age. And he states that the wicked are gathered up, taken up first out from among the righteous, the good fish, thrown into the furnace of fire. And once more, Jesus is plainly teaching the exact opposite of a lot of people telling us today, that the righteous are taken up and the wicked are left behind. Here it says that everybody's gathered up and the wicked are pulled out, and then the righteous get to shine. And when I have to try to figure out which one's right, I'll tell you this much, I will always side with Jesus and the Bible rather than people. And so if Jesus says it, that's good enough for me. And I'm not going to worry about what all these people tell me, which is the exact opposite of what Jesus says. Jesus says it's all done at the end of the age, the last day. We keep on looking in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 through 58. And it tells us that in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we shall all be changed. Now I say this, starting in verse 50. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Excuse me. But I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. You know, that sounds an awful lot like 1 Thessalonians 4. the trumpet of God, and we're all going to rise up and we're all going to be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when the perishable will put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that which is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord. See, the return of Jesus isn't supposed to be something we argue about. It's supposed to be words of comfort. Things that we can hope in, that we can lean in, that we can know as our goal. And if all of us are changed at the same time, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, so how many trumpets will be after that? None. So that would probably be the First Thessalonians. It's probably going to be the same time because we're all going to be changed there. And there's a trumpet of God. It deals with that. The seven trumpets in Revelation, this got to be either after them or part of them, the last one, because it's all this. And we will be changed from mortals to immortals, from the perishable to the imperishable. When Jesus returns on the last day to take us home, to be with him, to let us all be changed, all will be great for everyone who loves him and loves his appearing and have been faithfully obedient to his gospel. And then Jesus further taught more in Matthew chapter 25, 31 through 46 about that day regarding one great judgment for all. Matthew records as saying, but when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he's going to separate them out from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Once more, Jesus is saying an awful lot like what he said in Matthew 13 about the tares, the end of the age. The great dragnet at the end of the age. There's going to be this great judgment scene when all the good and the bad are going to be separated out and there's going to be a judgment. The passage goes on to share how Jesus will judge them by what they have done for others, because whatever you have done for the least of these, you have done it unto me. That's how they treat Jesus. But every time we read about Jesus and his return, even though we aren't exactly told what the day or the hour is, we are told that we will all rise. The wicked will face a judgment. They will be cast into a lake of fire. The righteous will shine forth in the kingdom of God to be at home with the Lord forevermore and comfort one another with this. But the whole question is, are we ready for his return? There are many parables Jesus told about a master who left his servants in charge of things. And then he went on a journey. And he returns without warning, without an announcement. And when he returns, he finds some of those servants faithful, faithfully serving, doing what they've been called to do. But he also finds somebody who is not, who is doing nothing, who is caught, like Paul writes to the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, like a thief in the night. We're to live ready every day for the return of Jesus. We don't know if it's going to be today, tomorrow, or the next day. And yes, my wife would like to be there for all 3 days. I'd like to be there for all 3 days. Whatever day it is, I want to be there. We don't know which time it is. We don't know if it's going to be 1,000 years from now. But we do know Jesus will return. And when he comes, we're going to be changed from this mortal body. We will be given an immortal body. We will be ready for eternity. We will come and there will be a great judgment, and some people will be sentenced and be sent to a lake of fire that was prepared for the devil and his angels, not for people, but it was prepared for them. And God will reluctantly send people there. Or we get to go home and be with the Lord forevermore. We get to hear Jesus say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Come, enter into the place I have prepared for you." Are you ready for the last day? Are you ready if Jesus comes back now? Will you trust in Jesus so you're ready at all times? Lord, I thank you for this passage. I thank you, Lord, for these many verses that make it so plain that you are returning. And we're to be comforted by these words. We're supposed to find hope and peace in these words because we know that we are going to be ready for you. Help us to live faithful for you. Help us not to be caught unaware. Help us to be ready no matter what day Jesus comes back. Help us to understand that when he comes back, we better be ready. In Jesus' name, amen.